This video is brought to you by Guardio. If we plan to replace fossil fuels with renewable energy, we'll need batteries, as in a lot of batteries. And in the world of battery storage, lithium-ion batteries reign supreme. However, there is one big problem. We may not have enough lithium and other raw materials to make all the batteries we'd need. But what if I told you that we might have already found a possible solution in the form of a new battery that isn't constrained by a limited supply of a couple of scarce materials? Enter the sodium ion battery. And quick hint, it's sort of a big deal. I'm Ricky, and this is Tuba Da Vinci. Our efforts to replace fossil fuels with clean and renewable energy has been seriously paying off in the past decade. As of the making of this video, there are 16.5 million electric cars on the streets, with 2 million sold during this year's first quarter alone. That's a growth of 75% compared to the same period last year. In the US, a little over 600,000 EVs were sold in 2021, but that number is expected to hit over 4.7 million by 2030 and could go up into the billions around the world by 2040. That means the demand for batteries for transportation will continue to grow exponentially for the coming years. Considering that lithium-ion batteries make up between 95 and 99% of the EV battery market, that means that the demand for lithium and other scarce metals like nickel and cobalt for the electric car is only going to rise. But it's not just vehicles. To replace fossil fuels with intermittent renewables like solar and wind, we'll need to store the equivalent of at least 5% of our renewable energy production to balance out that intermittency. Pumped hydro is a reliable long-term energy storage solution. Still, even though 94% of the current energy storage available comes from pumped hydro, we can't really build those where we need them near PV power plants and wind farms, forcing us to use batteries instead. Right now, more than 90% of the batteries used for grid storage are also lithium-ion. Typically lithium iron phosphate. With wind and solar energy increasing by 5 and 6% annually in the coming decade, and EVs growing faster than ever before, we have to come to terms with a vital truth. Lithium and other components for lithium-ion battery are hardly inexhaustible resources. While we're not exactly running out of lithium just yet, there are some red flags. So much demand for this alkali metal has sent its prices through the roof, increasing more than sevenfold in the past couple of years. But of course, lithium isn't the only problem. These batteries require other rare elements like manganese and cobalt, which are in much lower supply and only available in a few countries. Some of which, like the Democratic Republic of the Congo, are weighed down by environmental and humanitarian concerns. Now, many companies are trying to move away from cobalt in their batteries, but there are still some other concerns to address. Now, when there aren't enough resources to go around, suppliers are forced to decide where to allocate their products, affecting lithium battery production. With lithium batteries being so ubiquitous, this has the potential to affect all of us. Can you imagine what would happen if suppliers all of a sudden decided to prioritize EVs and grid storage and we ran out of batteries for things like iPhones and laptops? However unlikely, it's a scary thought we need to consider. A scary thought that's largely out of our control, but online privacy and security, while scary, is in our control, and where our sponsor this week comes in. Guardio is the browser extension for Chrome and Edge that you have to check out if you want to be on top of your security and privacy online. As a resident IT guy in my neighborhood, a neighbor recently asked me to check out his computer, and I was shocked by the amount of malware he had installed. I take online security very seriously, which is why I use Guardio. Guardio acts as the first line of defense as opposed to the standard solution that only really helps you once the threat is already on your device. These days, as our team grows, more people have access to our sensitive information, which can be hacked or leaked as a result of one tiny mistake. So I made sure to install Guardio on all of our computers. Each user can add 4 additional members with no additional cost and protect them from scams, phishing attempts, malware, identity theft, and many more threats. And that's not all. If you sign up through mobile, you'll get a free email scan to detect existing data leaks and get real-time alerts so you can take action right away. Look, the freedom that we love about the internet may come with a price, so stay one step ahead and have a trusted ally in your corner with Guardio. Join the 1 million users already using Guardio and save up to 20% off an affordable monthly subscription using my special link, guard.io/TubaDaVinci. Huge thanks to Guardio and you for supporting the show. Needless to say, when it comes to a clean, green future for our planet, we cannot put all of our eggs in one lithium-ion basket. So we need to find an alternative energy storage solution, one that is at least as energy and power dense as lithium-ion, so we can use it for things like EVs and laptops, but that is also made of an abundant material that is environmentally friendly and easy to extract. This is where the sodium-ion battery comes in. For chemists, an obvious solution to the lithium problem would be to replace it with its closest cousin, sodium. Like lithium, sodium is an alkali metal and shares many of the same chemical properties, but with some key differences. As the sixth most abundant element on the planet, sodium is more than 100 times more abundant than lithium in the Earth's crust. We can find it virtually everywhere, starting with salt water, where it's found as sodium chloride. This makes sodium much cheaper than lithium and an almost inexhaustible resource. For a quick comparison, mining lithium can cost anywhere between $15,000 and $32,000 per metric ton, depending on the source. And as I mentioned before, prices have ballooned ridiculously in the past 2 or 3 years, with lithium hydroxide increasing roughly 250% and lithium carbonate increasing approximately 413% since the beginning of 2021, according to S&P Global. On the other hand, sodium is not only 100 times more abundant, but also 100 times cheaper than lithium, as mining sodium ranges between $150 and $380 per metric ton. This makes sodium an ideal alternative for battery manufacturing, if we can get it to work like lithium, that is. And that's a big if. So, to see if we can, let's start with how these batteries actually work. As you may imagine, sodium batteries work very similarly to lithium ion batteries. Just like other chemical batteries, they have a cathode, an anode, and an electrolyte. The cathode contains a sodium salt or oxide that provides the sodium ions. Similarly to how in the lithium battery, the cathode contains different types of lithium compounds that provide lithium ions. When we charge the battery, electrons are pushed by an electrical potential difference toward the anode, where the accumulating negative charge attracts the sodium ions. These move from the cathode to the anode through the electrolyte. In the anode, they fit nicely in the little interstitial spaces between the layers of the anode material. Typically graphite or something like that. To draw power out of the battery, we let electrons flow back to the cathode from the anode through an external circuit or load, our phones for example, and at the same time, the sodium ions push back to the cathode through the electrolyte. Now, this is pretty much where the similarities between sodium and lithium-ion batteries end. As it turns out, you can't simply swap one element for another and expect everything to work the same way. For instance, instead of a graphite anode, sodium ion batteries use hard carbon materials, but more on that in just a little bit. For the cathode's active material, lithium ion batteries use one of several oxides with transition metals like cobalt, manganese, and nickel to help increase battery life and improve energy density. In the case of sodium ion batteries, there are three distinct variations in the cathode material leading to three types of batteries, namely polyanion batteries, Prussian blue analogs, or PBAs, and layered oxide batteries. Polyanion batteries use metal oxide clusters with discrete molecular structures and negative charges. Their robust 3D framework significantly decreases the structural stress when sodium ions go in and out of the structure. This helps improve cycle stability and safety, but also lowers electric conductivity and capacity, which restricts their application. The second type is known as Prussian blue analogs. Prussian blue is a dark blue pigment produced by the oxidation of salts containing iron and cyanide. It's known for being relatively low cost with a highly stable open three-dimensional crystal structure, which makes it ideal for batteries since it lets ions in and out easily. The benefit of these two battery chemistries is that they largely eliminate the need for many of the transition metals, like nickel and cobalt, that are prevalent in lithium ions. This doesn't just make them cheaper, but it also means there's less chance of a supply chain bottleneck when we scale to global production, something we absolutely need to do if we want to get rid of fossil fuels. But there's a trade-off, because these materials have low atomic packing densities, so they have fewer sodium ions per unit volume, meaning, you guessed it, lower energy density. Finally, there are the layered oxide batteries. These are much more similar in structure to standard lithium ion batteries and are the most studied type of sodium ion battery. The key difference, though, is that instead of nickel, cobalt, and manganese oxides, which are in a shorter supply than even lithium, these sodium batteries use iron and magnesium oxides, which are far more abundant. As a consequence, the sodium cathode, which makes up about 44% of the total battery cost, is much cheaper to produce and is much more widely available than the lithium cathode. Faradion, the company that seemingly gave birth to the sodium ion battery, claims their current in-development layered oxide battery will be 25 to 30% cheaper than lithium iron phosphate batteries at scale. But if they're cheap and work like lithium ion, why don't we see lithium ion batteries everywhere? What's the holdup? There's plenty to unpack here. You see, costs and supply chains aren't the only things we need to look at. The first thing to consider is performance. This is where sodium batteries start losing ground to lithium. The biggest problem is that capacity depends on how many sodium ions you can pack in the cathodes and anodes crystal structures. But sodium ions are much bulkier than lithium ions, and so they take up more space. This implies that in most crystal structures, there will be fewer sodium ions per unit volume than in similar lithium compounds. Therefore, sodium batteries tend to have lower energy densities or energy per unit volume. Furthermore, sodium ions are over 3 times heavier than lithium ions. So sodium batteries also tend to have lower specific energy densities than lithium ion batteries do. For example, at the time of this video, Faradion claims to have developed a layered oxide sodium ion battery cell that can achieve energy densities of around 160 to 170 watt hours per kilogram. While this falls in lithium ions range of 100 to 265 watt hours per kilogram, it's still on the lower end of the spectrum. On the other hand, the company also says that it's in the process of developing a battery that can reach up to 200 watt hours per kilogram. To reach those higher numbers, though, the battery chemistry would need to be at least 50% nickel. This reintroduces one of those materials prone to supply bottlenecking. So it sort of undermines the whole point of the sodium ion battery in the first place. Then there's the issue of scaling. Sodium ion hasn't been around for as long as lithium ion, and as a result has received far less attention, investment, and R&D. However, Faradion was recently bought by a major Indian solar company called Reliance Industries, which has said they plan to scale up sodium ion battery production over the next 2 years, hopefully producing between 10 and 20 gigawatt hours by 2024. This is a major win for Faradion and its battery tech. But the biggest promise for sodium is that the largest battery manufacturer in the world, Chinese behemoth Contemporary Amperex Technology Limited, or CATL, got in on the game in 2021 when they announced the launch of a 160 watt hour per kilogram sodium ion battery. They also claim to have a second generation battery in the works that can reach upwards of 200 watt hours per kilogram. Contrary to Faradion's solution, which is a layered oxide battery, CATL is building a PBA battery with Prussian white, an inexpensive, easy to produce material that can maintain 95% capacity after 10,000 cycles. This is an order of magnitude improvement in battery life over lithium. The best part is that this battery will only rely on earth-abundant materials, meaning it could scale for decades without ever hitting a bottleneck. Now, if you remember earlier in the video, I mentioned how sodium ion batteries use hard carbon anodes. Hard carbon are forms of carbon that can't be turned into graphite. They can be made from dozens of materials, but currently there isn't a robust supply chain for manufacturing hard carbon anodes. Fortunately, CATL is a big company, and it developed its own material, which enables abundant storage given the battery's performance and life cycles similar to graphite. Because of these features, CATL says that their battery will be 40 to 50% cheaper than lithium ion, aiming at a long-term cost of around $40 per kilowatt hour, less even than lithium iron phosphate batteries that are currently around $80 to $100 per kilowatt hour. As far as scaling, CATL says they will use the same equipment already used to build their lithium ion batteries. Still, the company doesn't expect to have their supply chain in place until at least 2023, meaning it could still be another 5 years before they reach large-scale commercial operation. So, to summarize, sodium ion batteries are cheaper to produce and use fewer hard-to-find materials, depending on the particular chemistry. But their energy densities are on the lower end of lithium ion, but not that different. Plus, it will take at least 5 to 7 years for the industry to begin catching up to lithium ion. So it's safe to say that we won't see them storing solar energy or powering your EV anytime soon, at least for a few years. But even if their performance can't compete with the best lithium ion batteries, that doesn't mean they're not valuable. Considering the amount of energy storage needed to replace fossil fuels, we'll need every energy storage technology we can get our hands on, not just sodium ion batteries. Perhaps in the future, lithium ion batteries will be reserved for those applications where only the highest possible energy densities can be used. I'm not even talking about electric cars, I'm talking about electric planes and helicopters. On the other hand, sodium ion will likely benefit applications where energy density and small size aren't as important, like grid storage, which is exactly where I think sodium ion batteries will first revolutionize the game. We need to start developing competitive battery technology now to begin taking some of the strain off of our current battery materials. How great would it be to not have to just have one battery technology eating up 90% of the market, but a robust, competitive battery marketplace with dozens of technologies filling up the landscape? Sounds like a win-win to me. So I think the future of sodium-ion batteries is vitally important. And yes, they are still decades away from where lithium-ion is today. But with just how much of a game changer they are and how affordable they're going to be, I think you're going to see tons and tons of investment over the next 10 years in sodium-ion battery research. But what do you think? Do the sodium-ion batteries' cost and material benefits outweigh their lower energy density? Would you be willing to buy the same Tesla for 20% less money in exchange for a slightly lower range but longer battery life? Sound off in the comments below. All right, that is a look at sodium-ion batteries. I think they're going to be a really big game changer. I'm going to try to reach out to some companies that are doing the research, like Faradion or even CATL, maybe do an on-site episode in the future. So stay tuned for that. But in the future, check out this video next. I'm Rigotube Da Vinci. We'll catch you guys next week.